Here we are almost 6 months later, and the pricing effects from cryptocurrency mining are still around. Howdy, howdy, guys. Ponchato here, and today we're going to take a look at what might be the only saving grace left in budget gaming, NVIDIA's GTX 1050 Ti. This card was released just about a year ago in late October of 2016 at a launch price of $139 US and is one of the few cards still available at close to its launch price. It runs at a core frequency of 1291 MHz and comes with 4 GB of GDDR5 memory at a speed of 1752 MHz, giving it a memory bandwidth of 112 GB per second. It's equipped with 768 shaders and is rated for 2,138 gigaflops of floating point performance. NVIDIA recommends a 400 watt power supply, and the card is rated for a 75 watt TDP. That means it doesn't require an extra PCIe power connector to function. Summed up in real world terms, this is a lower mid-range card with 4 gigs of memory that you can drop into just about any system with a x16 PCIe slot. The specific card I'm testing today comes from Zotac, their GTX 1050 Ti Mini, which is designed for cramped cases as it's only 145mm or 5.7 inches long, barely reaching past the PCIe slot itself. It's a dual slot card but a single slot bracket, so it vents into the case rather than out the back, and comes with a DVI, HDMI, and DisplayPort connection, par for most cards below $200. The test setup today is my tank build with an i5-7500 and 8 GB of DDR4 2400 memory, and all benchmarks are run at 1080p. First on the list is Battlefield 1. Like most cross-platform games, this was designed to run acceptably on consoles, so a 1050 Ti should be able to handle it pretty easily. On low settings, the 1050 Ti manages 144 FPS average with 1% lows at 76 and 0.1% lows at 48 frames per second. On medium settings, the average drops to 92 with lows at 63 and 52, while on high, the average drops to 63 with lows at 47 and 41. Maxed out at ultra settings, the 1050 Ti comes up just short of the magic 60 FPS number at an average of 59, with lows at 45 and 40. Battlefield 1 is a highly optimized game, so it's no surprise that the 1050 Ti can max it out and still keep up smooth and playable frame rates. Next up, Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Being an esports title, it's easy to run, but high-level players are extremely sensitive to FPS drops, so let's look at the 1050 Ti's performance. On low settings, it averages just under 298 frames per second, with 1% lows at 137 and 0.1% lows at 46. On medium settings, the average is 281, with lows at 143 and 74 frames per second, and on the highest settings, the 1050 Ti averages 217 FPS with 1% lows at 79 and 0.1% lows at 26 frames per second. Looks like the 1050 Ti can handle CSGO with ease. Third on the list is Deus Ex Mankind Divided. This is the most graphically intensive game I test, so even the mid-range 1050 Ti is going to have some trouble. On low settings, it averages 51 FPS with lows at 39 and 37. Medium settings drop that average by 10, while the lows hit 32 in the 1% case and 31 in the 0.1% case. On high settings, average FPS is 35, 1% lows are 27, and 0.1% lows are at 25. On very high settings, the game just barely manages 30 FPS with lows at 24 and 23. On the Ultra, the 1050 Ti makes it basically unplayable, 25 FPS average with lows at 14 and 11 FPS each. Even if you're okay with playing at 30 frames per second, anything above high settings is going to be pretty rough in Deus Ex. Next, GTA 5. Since this is a cross-platform game released with consoles, we should be able to get very good performance from the 1050 Ti. On low settings, we run into the ever-present stutter problem, with average FPS at 123 and lows at 8 and 7 respectively. The game isn't playable on these settings. At medium, however, the game runs much more nicely, 81 FPS average, 1% lows at 59, and 0.1% lows at an unobtrusive 46. Even on high settings, the performance is still great, 68 FPS average, 50 FPS 1% lows, and 39 FPS 0.1% lows. That's good enough to effectively max out GTA 5 with a 1050 Ti and not have to worry about the frame rate. Next up, Just Cause 3. Performance in this game is quite finicky, but it does tend to prefer NVIDIA GPUs, so we should see some pretty nice frame rates. Indeed, on low settings, the game averages 105 FPS with lows at 52 and 47. On medium, the average is similar at 99 FPS, but lows drop a bit, 48 FPS for the 1% lows and 39 FPS for the 0.1% lows. On high settings, the 1050 Ti averages just under that magic 60 FPS number with 58 frames per second. Lows drop to 33 in the 1% case and 28 in the 0.1% case. Given these results, the game is perfectly playable on high settings at 1080p and looks amazing. Moving on, let's look at Overwatch. It's an esports title, and since it was produced by Blizzard, it's crazy well optimized. On low settings, the 1050 Ti averages 232 FPS, with lows at 193 and 169. Medium settings put it at 173 FPS average, 146 FPS 1% lows, and 126 FPS 0.1% lows. On high settings, the average is 136 with lows at 116 and 106, while on Ultra, the average is 116 with lows at 195, the first time it drops below 100. Maxed out on Epic settings, the game averages 82 FPS with 1% lows at 71 and 0.1% lows at 68. That's enough to call the 1050 Ti good for maxing out Overwatch at 1080p and still maintaining better than 60 FPS. Seventh in the list is one of the most popular games in recent history, PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds. It's early release, it's unoptimized, and they're still making significant changes to performance every few months, so if you're watching this in the future, these results may be off or just completely inaccurate, depending on how they patch the game. Anyway, for right now, this is how the 1050 Ti handles PUBG. On very low settings, the game averages 89 FPS, 1% lows sit at 53, and 0.1% lows hit 27 frames per second. On low settings, the average drops to 70 FPS, 1% lows hit 39, and 0.1% lows go down to a fairly harsh 17 FPS. Medium settings are the highest you can go and still maintain 60 FPS average. 1% lows sit at 32, and 0.1% lows hit 16. On high, the average drops to 52 frames per second with lows at 30 and 15. And on ultra, the game is actually surprisingly smooth, 40 FPS average, 27 FPS 1% lows, and 14 FPS 0.1% lows. I personally wouldn't play like that, but if you're a glutton for eye candy, the 1050 Ti can still keep you covered. That aside, this GPU is good for 60 FPS at medium settings in PUBG. Last in the lineup is Rocket League, another esports title, but on top of that, it's cross-platform with consoles, so you can get some pretty ridiculous FPS numbers, even with a mid-range GPU like the 1050 Ti. On low settings, it averages well over 300 FPS, with 1% lows at 234 and 0.1% lows at 175. On medium, those numbers drop considerably, down to 184 FPS average, 129 FPS 1% lows, and 56 FPS 0.1% lows. On the highest settings, the game averages 110 FPS, with lows at 76 and 46 frames per second. Don't let the chart mislead you, though. The bars on high settings look short, but that average is still nearly double most monitors' refresh rates. The 1050 Ti can easily max out Rocket League settings. To give you guys a better general idea of performance from the graphics cards and CPUs I test, I'm introducing a new section to my benchmarks covering average FPS across multiple games. I have it split into two charts, average FPS in esports titles and average FPS in non-esports titles. The reason for this is that performance in esports titles is radically different than that of typical games like GTA 5 or PUBG. If you average performance from PUBG with performance in CSGO, you'll get a number that's meaningless for both games. First, we'll look at the non-esports average. These results are the combined numbers from Battlefield 1, Deus Ex Mankind Divided, GTA 5, Just Cause 3, and PUBG. The low settings will net you just over 100 frames per second, with lows at 45 and 33. Note that GTA 5's stuttering glitch is messing up these lows quite a bit. On medium settings, you can expect around 75 FPS average, with lows at 47 and 37 frames per second. On the highest settings, average FPS is usually around 50, while 1% lows sit at 34 and 0.1% lows hit 27. Based on this, if your target is 60 FPS average, the 1050 Ti will get you there with somewhere between medium and high settings, depending on the game. Next, average performance in esports titles. This is the combined average from CSGO, Overwatch, and Rocket League. Low settings will net you about 290 FPS average, 188 FPS 1% lows, and 130 FPS 0.1% lows. On medium, the average drops to 213, with lows at 139 and 85. Finally, on high or max settings, the average sits at 136 FPS, 1% lows are around 76 frames per second, and 0.1% lows drop to 47. Based on these results, if your goal is 120 or 144Hz gaming, the 1050 Ti can very nearly max out games and still hit that average. Next, we'll look at power consumption and temperatures. Comparing temperatures on GPUs is a bit less accurate than CPUs, since basically every card has a different cooler, but we can at least get some ballpark numbers. These temperatures were measured in a room at 24 degrees Celsius, and power consumption figures are for the entire test setup as measured from the wall. At idle with the 1050 Ti, the system drew 47 watts, and the GPU settled at 33 degrees Celsius. While stress testing with Unigine's Valley, the system drew a surprisingly small 106 watts, and the 1050 Ti leveled out at 62 degrees Celsius. A nice note here is that the GPU fan never had to spin up past 45% speed, the minimum allowed by its BIOS, and was essentially inaudible over the other fans in the case. In short, the GTX 1050 Ti is a great value card for 1080p mining, especially considering we're still in the middle of this cryptocurrency thing. It's generally good for medium to high settings while maintaining 60fps and easily maxes out esports titles at somewhere around 100 to 200 frames per second. On top of this, it doesn't use much power, doesn't need a 6-pin power cable, doesn't get very hot, and doesn't make much noise. I've actually switched over to the 1050 Ti now full-time rather than using my RX 480, mostly because the 1050 Ti is so much quieter and so much cooler, while still delivering performance that's more than enough for my needs. To pick up a 1050 Ti for yourself, click the link in the description. If you want to get notified of new videos as soon as they're up, hit subscribe and click the bell icon to enable notifications. So guys, if you like this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe. And if you have any questions about the 1050 Ti or the benchmarks, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching, I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.